don't hear you. If you're happy and you know it, stomp your feet. If you're happy and you know it, and your smile will surely show it. If you're happy and you know it, stomp your feet. If you're happy and you know it, say amen.
Amen.
Same house. We don't plan what we do. She does what the Lord leads her to do. And the Lord leads me what to do. This book has been open before she got up here. Turn to 169. Let me live, blessed Lord, in the light of thy word. Let my life be a light. play.
Take away
as eyes that now can see. Deprive me of the food I eat, and even burn my hands and my feet. But as long as I know Jesus, then I can still go free. That I could still go free. What kind of man would reach down his head and do this for me? Unworthy to live and not fit to kill, yet a man on the cross put me in his will and said that I could still go free. Now I never could quite understand why King would want to leave his throne to don the robe of an earthly man, feel the pain of flesh and bone, and to later trod that lonely path that led to Calvary. For those blood red stains broke all my chains so that I could still go free. That I could still go free. What kind of man would reach down his head and do this for me? Oh, I was unworthy to live and not fit to kill. Then a man on the cross put me in his will and said that I could still go free. He said that I could still go free.
We were out working yesterday over in Owsley County just a little while, and was working on the machine, and if I pulled my sleeve up right here, you'd see the imprints of something in my skin right now. It looks like a grill. What it was is we was working on a seal coat machine. We had kind of an issue with it there, and I accidentally set my arm down on the pump, which was very, very hot, and it seared marks right there. And it hurt so bad most of the day. But when I did that, I got to thinking just a little bit. It just lasted for a minute, and it hurt. It just lasted for just a second. But hell's an eternity. You know that? And I remember growing up, old preachers, they'd preach hell a lot, and they'd preach it hot. And they preached torment, and they preached things. And AJ, he shared some stuff with the kids that, you know, he didn't want to go to hell. It was the reason he wanted to be saved. We don't preach hell hot anymore. But there was a man that come and took my spot.
Yep.
and hung on that cross and went through my hell for him.
Right.
You know that? And took that away so that I could be free.
Amen.
So that I, so unworthy, could join him one day in an eternal and glorious place.
Yeah.
We've been reading about just a little bit. I look forward to seeing the great thing at the throne of God. I look forward to that. I look forward to seeing the rainbow over him. I look forward to seeing his presence and his power. And Wednesday night, we talked about how we'll take on some of that glory, even though we're so undeserving of it. It's Father's Day. I'm blessed with a great Father.
Yeah,
I'm blessed with a great earthly Father. But I am more overjoyed with our heavenly Father this morning and what he did for us so that we could still go free. Give me that G. Just listen to this second verse. Listen to this second verse one more time. I'm a horrible singer on this, but it's got such great words. And if you're here today and you're locked in bondage, you know, we love you, right, church?
Amen.
We love you. We love you. If the Lord wills this evening, and it's still pressed on me, I'm going to do something in Bible school this evening that I've not done, and I've been teaching this older class for over 20 years now. But I'm going to do something tonight I've never been led done before. I'm not going to say what it is. I may talk a little bit more about it at the end of the service. They'll see it when they get here this evening. But somebody this morning needs to be set free. Amen. You need to be set free. Get your mind on God. Get it off the things that's out there. Don't stress this morning. Get your mind on God. All right? A blessing for me this morning as a father is to see my children here with me.
Yeah.
You know it? And you fathers that's got your children here, you'll say the same thing. I'll do anything for them, but I can't set them free.
Right.
You know it? I can't set them free. Your daddy's children will do anything for you if you've got a good daddy. They'll give you life, but they can't set you free. But let me share with you one more time about a man that can set you free.
Amen.
Okay, just one more time. You listen. All right? Now never could quite understand why a king would want to leave his throne to don the robe of an earthly man, feel the pain of flesh and bone, then to later trod that lonely path that led to Calvary, but those blood red stains broke all my chains so that I can still go free, that I could still go free. What kind of man would reach down his head and do this for me? For I was so unworthy to live, and I wasn't fit to kill. Then a man on the cross put me in his will and said that I could still go free. And he said that I could still go free.
Thank you, Lord, praise your name for the breath that I breathe. Thank you, Lord, you've been so good. to me. Please keep me humble and to work for Thee. Thank You, Lord, for saving me. I needed You so bad. You saved my soul. When we pray, we don't care what people say. Thank You, Lord, You've been so good to us. And Lord, keep us humble. We want to work for Thee. Thank You, Lord, for saving me.
I'm just glad to be saved.
Amen. You saved my soul, and I'm so glad. Please use me, Lord, that's my plea. Let the light shine in me, so the whole world can see. Thank You, Lord, for saving me. Yes, thank You, Lord. He's glad to be saved.
Amen.
If you're here and you love the Lord, say amen.
Amen.
Amen. Thank God forever. Good to be back in the house of the Lord this morning. Good to see the ones that were able to come and be with us. And happy Father's Day to all you fathers. And we thank God for you. Amen. And we really do. You mean the world to us. And we got some of the best here in our church, I'll tell you, we really do. I thank God for them. It's an honor to serve the Lord with you and worship God with you. And you might be saying, preacher, well, I never had a child. Well, you're still a father figure to a lot of people that maybe you haven't even realized. Help people. There's a lot of people in this church that help people that ain't even their natural child. They help them, and I thank God for you. So happy Father's Day. We got something for you here. When you leave this morning, we ain't gonna leave you here without nothing. We've got something to give you. So we thank God for that. Thank God for our church. It's a pleasure to be here. Stephen said we're starting Bible school tonight. We look forward to that. Man, I tell you what, I don't know if you could have found a better crew to be a decorating downstairs this morning. I mean, Sundays are getting with it, and I stand there watching them. So, ain't no use lie about it. I mean, I ain't a decorator. I'm the preacher. I ain't a decorator. I'm bad at that. So, lucky to get my shoes tied on right of the morning. But I appreciate all the hard work. Our church gets really excited about Bible school, and I'm glad it's that way. Amen. We'll reach children this week, church, that may sow the initial seed in their heart that they need Jesus. Do you realize that? That's how important that Bible school is. It's not just getting together and having fun. We're going to do that. But in the process of that, they're going to learn about the mighty God that we serve. I mean, he knows he's a mighty God, very mighty God. And you're going to learn about him this week. So starting at 6 tonight, 6:30 the rest of the week, I believe, if I'm correct on that. So we're just looking forward to that. I appreciate the church and your prayers. Appreciate the ones that was able to come up and be with us. And I know that there were several more that would have loved to have been and just couldn't make it. But we're glad to appreciate y'all supporting us in revival this week. The only thing made it better to see somebody got saved. But you know what? One soul's one waters. God gives the increase. I preached Monday night about what goes down must come up, amen. And when the seed of Christ is laid in the right heart, buddy, it'll come up when it gets that water, and it'll do what's needed to be done, amen. So we appreciate y'all about that. And be praying for us. I've got revival on my mind for our church. How many'd like to see revival in our church? I believe we're ready for revival, and it could very well start tonight with Bible school and filter right on into the time that we have revival. Revival ain't a certain date, and it don't come through a certain preacher or certain activity. God sends revival. And the Christian needs to be willing to accept the revival of God. I tell you, we all need revival. You're looking at somebody that needs revival. When you look in the mirror, you're looking at somebody that needs revival, especially in the day and hour that we live in. Mark chapter 1, if you got your Bible. Mark chapter 1. I'm going to read a couple verses, and I've got some verses written down here that I want to go to, if the Lord would allow us to. And we are looking at a subject this morning that's fitting for the occasion, and it's what the Lord laid on our heart back earlier this week. And we thank God for what He blessed us with. Let's keep Brother Billy in our prayers this morning, that God would touch him in the hospital today. I'm glad He brought Sister LaDonna out of the hospital yesterday. And our God's a healer, church. I mean, that's the way it is, and He is. And we're still praying for Sister Leona and Brother Glenn. Sister Leona buried a sister this week, and we love y'all and praying for you there. And I know several of you went through trials and sicknesses and troubles. I'm glad you're here, amen. And we want to be an encouragement to you, and we want to pray one for another. So Mark chapter 1 and verse 19 is where we'd like to start at today. If you'd like to stand with us, you can this morning. And I told Jason, I looked out and thought I seen smoke out here, and then realized it's his birthday, and that was just the candles on his cake. He knew it was coming. He knew it was coming. I love him that good. I pick on him, and that's, I mean, we just have that kind of relationship. We love each other. I'd jump from the train for him, I tell you that right now. I love him that good. I'm the reason that him and Rhonda's married. It's my fault. I was in the back of the car going, No, Jason. I was just a little boy then, but I'm glad Jason said yes, Rhonda, because we love you too and your family. Love you all today. We like to cut up, but Mark 1, verse 19. Listen to what the Bible says. And when he had gone a little further thence, he saw James, the son of Zebedee, and John, his brother, who also were in the ship mending their nets. And straightway he called them, and they left their father Zebedee in the ship with the hired servants and went after him. Father, I love you today, and thank you so much for allowing us this opportunity to stand one more time. Maybe bring a word of encouragement. Maybe help somebody find peace. And most of all, Lord, this morning we want somebody to be saved. And we pray, God, that if you'd speak to that heart today, what a wonderful Father's Day gift to see a child come to Jesus, to see somebody saved. Lord, we know that you're dealing with hearts, even in our congregation. We can't see in those hearts. But God, we know that you're speaking to hearts, because we're begotten by the Word, and you were the Word that was made flesh, Jesus, and dwelt among us. And your Word is going out in song and testimony and Sunday school and preaching. Your witness is great in lives in this place. And I know that you're speaking to somebody. Help them, Lord. Whatever the distraction is, whatever it is that's holding them back, I pray today, now, will be that day of salvation. God, help us as Christians that are struggling with whatever. Help every Christian that is facing a trial. I pray you heal every sickness that you'd see fit to heal. And help us, God, to be together more now than we ever have been, to worship you in spirit and in truth. We honor you today, Jesus, and we love you. And we ask these things in your name, that you petition the Father on our behalf. In the mighty name of Jesus, our Savior. And the church said, amen. 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 You can be seated. Thank you so much for standing with us. I want to preach today on a thought, and I took a picture this morning of a page of statistics. I can't hardly say that word. Sorry, but statistics that I looked up. It's very disturbing. But I want to preach this morning on the worst kind of father is one that's missing.
The worst kind of father is one that's missing. And you say, preacher, what do you mean? Now, I'm not here by any way or any means or any form or any fashion to pick anything out of this Bible and say that Zebedee was a bad father, because I don't know that. I know this. I know that his sons worked with him on the ship, and they made a living, and evidently they must have made a pretty good living, because not everybody that run a fishing boat in the Bible days had hired servants. If they had hired servants, church, then their business was doing pretty good. Would you agree with that? And for Jesus to walk up and say, follow me, and them boys to drop their nets and leave that business, that life that they had grown up to know, and to say, we're going to follow Jesus because he's more important than the salary that we're making on this boat. It was probably hard to do, because I know how the flesh is. I deal with it every day. But I wonder why Zebedee didn't go. And I've wondered that several times. And like I say, I'm not casting judgment upon Zebedee. I know very little about him. The Bible only mentions him when it talks about James and John, that they was the two sons of Zebedee. Zebedee might have been a class act. He may have been a great man. But every time you read about James and John, it mentions them as the sons of Zebedee, so God put emphasis on it for some reason. But every time I've read it, it seems like he's missing. And I thought about that, and buddy, the Lord just stirred my heart. How many love children? How many love children? And as I said, we got some of the best dads in the world sitting here in this place right now. I know you. I see you. I see how you love your children. You've got them to church with you this morning. And if you haven't got them to church with you this morning, then you've called about them. They may be at the church that they've been called to go worship at. They may be doing what God has led them to do, but I've saw you sow those seeds of faith in their life. And I appreciate that as a pastor, that we've got good God-fearing praying daddies, amen, in our church. I appreciate that. We're not perfect. You're looking at the most imperfect one of them standing right here. I'm not perfect. I look at other dads and think, you know, they have qualities that I'd love to have, but God made me the way He made me, and I can only do what God led me to do. But, you know, I thought about this, but it just got to stirring in my heart about how the worst kind of father is one that's missing. You know, the older I get, you know, the one thing that I love to do more than anything is spend time with my children. The older I get, the more I want to do that. The more I want to be around them. The more I want that friendship with them. And not that I can't correct them when they go wrong. It's my job as a dad to correct them. Amen? Our Father corrects us. The Bible said without the chastening of the Holy Spirit that we're bastards and not sons. Ain't that what that says? It says despise it not. So God corrects us when we're wrong, and I'm glad for that. And it's our job to correct them when they're wrong. I struggle with that. I always thought that, you know, when Mom and Dad would tell me and Stephen, Stephen got a lot more trouble than I did. I'm going to put that right there out right now. But anyway, no, I've got to take that back. That's a lie. I'm sorry, made that up. But anyway, I thought about how they would tell us, you know, when they would correct us. If they had to, anybody in here won't be honest with me right now. How many of you's ever had a spanking? Anybody? Look around you. They're all alive. They survived. Amen. Little leather on the hind end never hurt anybody. Amen. It'll correct you. I mean, it's correction. There's a difference between beating somebody to death and correcting them, right? But they always said that'll hurt me worse than it does you. And I thought, there ain't no way that leather didn't hit your hide like it did mine. But now that I have children, I know what they meant. Amen. And I come from a generation, and how many come from this generation where your father and your grandfather was like a hero to you? Anybody come from that generation? You looked at them and you saw them work and you saw them strive, and they was something else. My two grandpas, my grandpa, he wore bibbed overalls every Sunday. He was raised up hard, and Dad, every time we go down Indian Creek, he'd tell us stories about we used to grow corn on this hillside, or we wrecked a tractor on that hillside, or this, that, and the other, and all kinds of different stories. But both my grandpas were hardworking men, and I'm going to say that probably every person in here had that same type of grandfather that growed up around him. and that they were, and you respected them. You know, me and Dad worked together for 20 years, and we probably fit every day. Ain't that right, Dad? Probably fit about every day. And I'm not talking about throwing down the gloves and getting out there slapping on another, but I'm talking about disagreeing on things. Tony was there with us. He could tell you, amen, him back there. We probably disagreed on stuff every day, but I look back at those days now that I had a father in my life that loved Jesus, and despite whatever that we disagreed on, at the end of the day, he was still my dad, I was still his son, and just water under the bridge, let's go on and try again tomorrow. Anybody relating with what I'm telling you right now? These fathers were figures in your life that was heroes almost. You just appreciated what they done. Stephen was talking about working this man right here, and I'm not here to brag on him or lift him up, but I believe in giving flyers while they're living, amen. I've seen a lot of people walk around caskets, church, that had regrets. I wished I'd have said this to Dad, or wished I'd have done this with Grandpa, or wished I'd have went this place with Mom, or I'd have called Mom more often. Listen, if it's on your mind to do it now. You may not have tomorrow, amen. But I thought about this morning when I was sitting there watching the sun come up, I began to think about, you know, there are so many times that I look back in my life and I can see that impact that these fathers, these type of father figures had in our lives. And just yesterday we worked all day, and this man got one leg, lost me bag, had a stroke, had an open heart surgery, stood there and drug a holes all over a parking lot all day long. And there's some men out here that's 30 and 40 year old that's too sorry to tie their own shoes, amen, that their children are being raised by other people because they won't get out and they won't go to work. I've got a personal vendetta, if you want to say that, about people like that, but I think they need Jesus, and if they get Jesus in their life, it'd change their whole attitude. They'd appreciate things more. Anybody relate with what I'm saying this morning? The worst kind of father is one that is missing, amen, one that never wants that relationship, one that never wants to commune with their children. And I put it like this: you know why we got such great dads in this church and such great men in this church? It's because they want to be around other people and they want to have something to do with other people's children, amen. And they're a light to them even when they don't realize it. There's some of them that's raising children that's not naturally theirs, amen. By virtue of nature, they wasn't the one that physically fathered them. But can I tell you something? Every one of us here today have the same Father, amen. And his name is God Almighty, and he sits upon the throne, amen. And because of Jesus, we've been adopted into the family of God. We've been grafted into the tree, amen. And because of that, we share the same bloodline, amen. And you've got people that we know every day. I bet some of you know people like this that you commune with in your life, amen, that didn't have natural children, but they've raised children. They've raised and been around children, and they love them just like their own. Anybody know somebody like that? They're a type of father, and they're a good father because they ain't missing, amen. What do you mean they're missing, Preacher Shane? A father, my friend, I looked it up to see what Merriam-Webster would have to say about this. This is what Webster in his dictionary defined a father as. He defined it as a man in relation to his child or has begotten a child. That's what he said a father was. He also said that it's a God sense, amen. He also said Father was the first person of the Holy Trinity, and that's all the truth, amen. So fathers are directly related to God. When you say the word father, you're automatically directly relating that person to a figure in their child's life that should be reflecting God Almighty. I struggle with this as much as anybody. I have to get up and fight with the flesh every day. Anybody else? I have to get up with them old voices that's speaking nonsense and trying to direct your thoughts on the things that's going on around you. And I have to submit myself to God. And when I submit myself to God, then it enables me to resist the devil And when I resist the devil, he parts ways, amen. He flees from us. So the devil knows when you want to be a good father. The devil knows when you want to be directly in a good relationship with your children. The devil knows, my friend, that when a father is present in a child's life and loves them the way that he has been loved and shows them the love that God has shown and corrects them when they need corrected and helps them when they need help them, he knows that's dangerous for him, because if he can't get to the father, he probably ain't going to get to the family. Because when you've got a father that's rooted and grounded in the Word of God and has that relationship and that love for Jesus, the devil, he might beat on him, but that man has armor on him. And when you've got that mother that is seated by that father that shares that same love, they're clothed up in that armor, and the devil's throwing them darts, and he's trying to kill and to steal and to destroy, and he wants nothing but everybody to go missing, amen. I'm preaching to help somebody today, to tell you that our Father loves us that way, and that the church is the mother of the Christians, amen. They're born again, and thank God forever when the mother and the father have that kind of relationship. The children's going to be blessed, amen. Church, could you raise your hand today and say, thank you, Father, for blessing me. You gave me more than I ever deserved. I love you with everything in me. Because of the Father, I have life, and I have it more abundantly. Because of that, I can have a relationship that I need to get by in this life. Amen. Well, praise the Lord. I thought about how that, I know I'm probably tormenting you all. I have to slap sometimes to get the flesh out of the way. This old microphone system, sometimes we just need to rear back and let her go. Amen. But I want you to look at some things with me in the Bible. I want you to go to Mark chapter 10, verse 35. Mark chapter 10 and verse 35. You're going to see a request in Mark 10 and 35. Jesus was beginning to prepare the disciples for his death. And something happened here in Mark 10 and 35. And notice how he starts. And James and John, who church? The sons of Zebedee, came unto him saying, Master, we would that thou should do for us whatsoever we shall desire. And he said unto them, what would ye that I should do for you? They said unto him, grant unto us that we may sit one on the right hand, the other on the left hand, in thy glory. And Jesus said unto them, you know not what ye ask. Can you drink of the cup that I drink of? Be baptized with the baptism that I am baptized with? And they said unto him, we can. And Jesus said unto them, you shall indeed drink of the cup that I drink of. And with the baptism I am baptized, you shall be baptized. But to sit on my right hand and on my left hand is not mine to give, but it shall be given to them for whom it is prepared. Who's he talking about? That's my Father's call. Amen? That's what he said. And he said, yes, you're going to drink the cup. You know what Jesus is talking about here, church? When he was in the garden praying, he said, Father, if it is your will, let this cup pass from me. I am nevertheless not my will, but thine be done. He drunk the cup of death for you and I. He drunk the cup of wrath for you and I. He drunk the cup, my friend, of all our failures for you and I. And he told them, said, yeah, you're going to drink of this same cup. You can go over and read the book of Acts, the 12th chapter. And one of these boys that asked this question, I heard set forth to kill him. And James, the brother of John, was killed with a sword. Amen. He drunk the same cup that Jesus did. John, I was after he had a marking on his head as well, a bounty, if you will. You go through the Bible, these men all died the death for the Lord Jesus Christ. But to sit there was not, my friend, the thing that Jesus was there to give them. Because he went on to tell them, when the other disciples heard it, there was jealousy sparked up. And Jesus began to tell them about about how that you know that they're counted to rule over the Gentiles, exercise lordship unto them, and their great ones exercise authority unto them. But so it shall not be among you. But whosoever will be great among you shall be your minister, and whosoever you will be the chiefest shall be servant of all. For the Son of Man came not to be ministered unto to, but to minister and to give his life a ransom for many. Amen. Jesus said, this is the order of my Father. We're all on the same level. God don't love one more than he does the other. But he was speaking from how his Father set things in effect. You know what the most dangerous thing is about a missing father? Is if a child never has any direction, the devil's going to have a heyday with them. Amen. He's going to send them out and make them think that I'm living it up with the world. I've got it all under control. I've got it all figured out. Let me tell you something. Every child needs a father that loves them, that will point them to Jesus. Amen. And I'm looking around here this morning, and I know I've got a church house full of them type fathers. Amen. But Zebedee was never mentioned. All it said was the son of Zebedee. The sons of Zebedee. Now let me show you this. I want you to go over to Matthew chapter 20. I'm trying to hurry. Matthew chapter 20. Sometimes we hurry the Spirit right out of the house of God if we ain't careful. Matthew chapter 20. Look at what happened. The same thing, only it was somebody different that made the request. Matthew 20 and verse 20 said, then came to him the mother of Zebedee's children. The mother came in to ask the request, not the father. And she came with her children, her sons, worshiping him and desiring a certain thing of him. So the mother of James and John saw that her sons was following this man, and she decided to fall in line. And then she went up there. And she asked the same thing. Grant that these my two sons may sit, the one on the right hand, the other on the left, in thy kingdom. A lot of people said, well, that was the same request that we just read. It was. But this said the mother asked it. That said James and John asked it. Maybe they asked it twice. I'm not a Bible scholar. I don't know. But what I do know is Zebedee was not in the picture. All he had there was the name mentioned. Amen. And again, I am not preaching on Zebedee. He may have been a great man of faith later on. But all I see in the Bible is he is missing a man. And the worst kind of father is a father that is missing a man. Still no Zebedee here. I want you to go to Matthew chapter 27. Let's look at this. This is where Jesus had died and was getting ready to be buried. Oh my goodness. They was taking him to Joseph's tomb. And the Bible said in verse 55 of Matthew 27, and many women were there beholding afar off, which followed Jesus from Galilee, ministering unto him, among which was Mary Magdalene and Mary the mother of James and Joseph, and who? The mother of Zebedee's children was standing out there with these other Marys, and she was out there worshiping God Almighty, wondering what was going to happen, wondering what was coming up of this man that had died. She was present, but Zebedee was nowhere to be found. The worst kind of father is a father that's missing. Amen. Because when a father goes missing, the structure goes missing. Hey church, please be faithful to God our Father. Amen. Please love him with everything in you. Please serve him with all your might. He's a good Father. Amen. He gives us more blessings than we ever deserved. He's better to us than we ever could have asked. He's took our faults and our failures. He's cast them as far as the east is from the west. Our transgressions are covered. Our Father let his only Son die for you, my friend. That's a Father that didn't want you to be missing. Oh, hear the preacher today. God don't want you missing in his heaven. Amen. Just as Brother Jim read this morning, Jesus said that in his Father's house were many mansions. If it were not so, I would have told you I go to prepare you a place. I don't know what I'm going to have in heaven. But thank God, God, my Father said, you've got a place. There's a place for you. There's a place for everybody up and down these hollers. There's a place for everybody you work with. There's a place that God has prepared. He wants it to be filled. But you, to get there, have got to believe in the Father. Amen. Amen. Every time the scripture mentions James and John, almost every time, it mentions their father Zebedee. I looked it up this morning. It mentions just about James and his brother John, the sons of Zebedee. But he's always missing. And I thought about, his mother wasn't missing in this scripture we just read when she witnessed what happened to Jesus. The worst tragedy that could ever happen on this earth. I'm going to say this because I believe it. It's not $5 a gallon gas. There's more people buying gas right now than they've ever been. You got to stand in line. I'm thinking, what in the world? Quit buying so much gas. That's bad. We ain't, hey church, on a serious note, we ain't saw hard times yet. You better get yourself grounded and faithful. You ain't saw hard times yet. It's about to get real bad. Bible says it is. Time's going to wax worse and worse. You know what the awfulest tragedy that's ever happened? It's for a child, when they get saved, a mom gets saved, a family gets saved, but the father does not. That'd be awful to look up out of hell and see your children. And you can't get to them. You couldn't get there. There ain't no ladder to climb up. Ain't no hand to reach down. There's a gulf fixed, the Bible says. Can't pass through that. God made it. You look up there and you see where you could have been all through eternity with your children. There they are, running and playing. Running and playing. Little baby died this week. Family is broken right now. Church ain't in a lot of prayer. Yeah. That baby is sitting in the lap of an almighty father. Yeah. It'd be awful to look up there and see little babies running and playing around the feet of Jesus. Singing like they do right here every Sunday. Praising God. And there you are. Because of the hardness of your heart, you died and went to hell. My goodness, you can't reverse that, friend. I tell you this out of love. I tell you that you don't have all the time in the world to make things right. All you need to do is be saved, and God will set it right. Don't you let your family go off to heaven and you not go with them. Me and Misty's got a little baby up there. I never held it. I never saw it. But it's there. You can amen or owe me that. These little babies that die in the womb are in the presence of Jesus. Amen and amen. My goodness. The worst kind of father is one that's missing. Can I tell you some real statistics? Come on, boys, and get us a song. I can't take it. Somebody needs salvation here today. Somebody listening needs salvation. This was done. This study was done, my friends, by the fatherhoodnetwork.org. Listen to these numbers. 63% of youth suicides come from a fatherless home. Hey, youngins, ain't nothing in this world worth taking your own life over. If you ever think you need to do it, you come and you slap the preacher upside the face and say, listen to me, preacher. You go find mom, you go find dad, you go find somebody. Amen, church? Amen. Don't do that. 63%, 90% of all homeless and runaway children, guess where they come from? Fatherless homes. 85% of all children who show behavior disorders come from fatherless homes. 80% of rapists with anger problems come from fatherless homes. 71% of all high school dropouts come from fatherless homes. Children with fathers who are involved in their life, ones that are not missing, are 40% less likely to have to repeat a grade. Children with fathers who are involved are 70% less likely to drop out of school. Listen, 75% of all adolescent patients in chemical abuse, substance abuse centers. I'm talking about drug rehabs, alcohol rehabs. 75% of them have a fatherless home, amen. This ain't made up. They asked these people. These people said, my dad was not there. My dad was not there.
Our father's right here. Amen. Right here. Amen. Right here. Amen. Right, brother. He's here. Boy, if you just could see how much he loves you. Amen. I preached about him Friday night. Yes, Brother Charles. Friday night. You know you're the apple of his eye? Amen. You're the one thing he desires. Not one person does God speak to his brother Tim. Coming up here tonight or this morning, does God expect them to get it figured out or get it fixed before they get to that altar? Mm-hmm. All he does, Jason, is speak to them. He loves us. I picked on Jason, but I see the love that he has for Matthew and Emily. And I think, man, that's awesome.
That's awesome. He loves them children more than anything. Do you love your children more than anything?
They're my prized possession. How about you?
Amen.
They ain't but one person has more love for a child than a mother. You know who it is?
It's God our Father. It's not His will, the Bible said in the book of Peter, that any would perish. God wants all His children to come home.
Amen.
And boy, it needs to start right now. Stand to your feet with us. It needs to start right now. Come on, as we say. Come on. The worst kind of father is one that's missing. Come on. You do as God says. You do as God says. You let God. I ain't going to think you've done nothing wrong. I know you ain't. Friend, it ain't about that today. Nobody's here to judge anybody. Nobody's here to point a finger at anybody. But we're here today because we love you. We don't want you to be missing. We don't want you to be missing in your family. We don't want you to be missing in heaven. Well, preacher, everybody makes mistakes. I've made more than I need to. Guilty. Guilty, guilty. So many mistakes I've made. I'll never be perfect as long as I'm in this flesh. But God didn't call me to be perfect. He called me to follow Him. He's the one that's perfect. And follow Him if He speaks to your heart today. Please follow Him. Wouldn't you love to see somebody follow Him today? Wouldn't you love to see somebody just step out, come and fall in the arms of Jesus? To have that love, to show that compassion, to have that peace, to have that joy. Wouldn't you love to see somebody step out and come to the Lord? Oh, it'd be a wonderful day to be saved. It'd be a wonderful day to come. Church house full of people right now that's praying. want to ask you something this morning. If you would bow your head with me for just a second, close your eyes. Nobody's looking around.